about the service, and I just invite you to join us for the first song.
Blood of least in my living, and those behind flows. Lieberstrom des Himmels, Ström im Überfluss, danke. Mein Erretter für alle Zeit. In mein ganzes Leben, das Liebe durch mich strömt. Ich bin dir ergeben, will dein Reich kommen sehen. Danke, Jesus, ich bin befreit. Meine Retter für alle. Danke, Jesus, ich bin befreit, meine Retter für alle Zeit.
Good morning, church. Welcome, welcome, welcome. As you can see, Diazno is with us today. Give him a warm welcome right now. And today is a very special day for many reasons. I will talk about the German or the Day of German Unity a little bit later, but today is, in German, it's called Erntedankfest. I know that in English it's kind of Thanksgiving for Harvest. I looked it up, it's kind of Harvest Festival or something, but we give praise for to God today in a very special manner. And today I wanted to start this service with a very special, psalm. Psalm 119. For those of you who know the Bible, who know the book of Psalms, I'm not going to read all of Psalm 119 because it is the longest one in the book of Psalms, and it's actually the longest chapter in the Bible. But I want to read to you the last verses of that psalm. And I hope, no, you cannot see it on the screen yet. Psalm 119 says, may my cry come, Psalm 119 verses 169 to 176. May my cry come before you, Lord. Give me understanding according to your word. May my supplication come before you. Deliver me according to your promise. May my lips overflow with praise, for you teach me your decrees. May my tongue sing of your word, for all your commands are righteous. May my hand be ready to help me, for I have chosen your precepts. And then it continues. I long for your salvation, Lord, and your laws give me delight. Let me live that I may praise you, and may your laws sustain me. I have strayed like a lost sheep. Seek your servant, for I have not forgotten your commands. And so I want us to praise our Lord today, as this Bible verse says, may my tongue sing of your word. And so we continue to worship right now with two more songs. Get up, open your hearts, open your minds, and just get into this worship right now.
How can we not give praise?
redemption. And you deserve it all, you deserve it all. Oh, yes, you are the one, there's no one above you who can compare to you. Yes, you are the one, there's no one beside you who else deserves our praise. Yes, you are the one, there's no one above you who can compare to you. Jesus, you are the one, there's no one beside you.
Earth as it is.
let heaven come to earth as it is in heaven. Let heaven come. 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 Your will, your way. Let heaven come. Let heaven come. And yours is the kingdom, and yours is the power, yours is the glory forever. Amen. Yours is the kingdom, and yours is the power. Let heaven come. Let heaven come in our hearts. Let heaven come. 'Cause yours is the kingdom, and yours is the power. Is the power, yours is the glory.
Let's pray. God, we are incredibly thankful for this day. For this day of German unity, for this day of giving thanks for the harvest, for this Sunday where we can come together to celebrate you, to worship you, to praise you. And we are thankful for everyone in the room, and we ask for your presence to be with us today. In your name, amen. Thank you so much, Diasno and Brian, for leading us in worship. We will worship a little bit more at the end of the service. Yes, as I mentioned, today is the day of German unity, and there is a lot to celebrate for. A lot of things happened in this country in the past 31 years. And so I have a Bible verse for you, and because it's the German national holiday, I will read the verse in German. And so for those of you who can't understand German, you can see the English verse on the screen as well. Und so im zweiten Brief an die Korinther schreibt Paulus, im Übrigen, Brüder und Schwestern, freut euch, kehrt zur Ordnung zurück, lasst euch ermahnen, seid eines Sinnes, haltet Frieden. Dann wird der Gott der Liebe und des Friedens mit euch sein. So, the day of German unity. Some of you may know that I grew up in the German Democratic Republic on the countryside, 1 hour northern of Berlin. And so when I grew up, I didn't see much of the wall or didn't really, we didn't really got a lot about politics and so on. We were just on the countryside. There were like 150 people living in our small village that was located between two lakes, and we were a lot outside in the woods. And but I do remember that there was a Russian military base very close to our little village, and we always greeted the Russian soldiers when they went to the base and when they left. And I can remember that at the beginning of the 90s they left for the last time, and we were like cheering them as like we used to do that. And at that time they were not so, they were a little confused because it seemed like we were celebrating that they were leaving. But for us as kids, it was just a normal thing to do. And I can remember the stories that my mother tells me about the German Democratic Republic, how she was not allowed, or how it was very incredibly difficult for her to get to university because she was not part of the SED, the Socialist Party at that time. I can remember that my grandparents were actually in this party and officials. And so I belong to this generation. I was born at the beginning of the 80s. And so in the 90s was like my teenage years. And usually for a teenager, you look for mentors, you look for people who can guide you, and they can help you set up a career and everything. But where I grew up in the 90s, everyone was like trying to find out, how does this new system work? How do we make a career? All of the adults in my life had like a career until 1990, and then they had to start over at the beginning of the 90s. And so German unity, when I think about that, I think about all the struggles in the 90s, how difficult it was to bring together two countries and two different kinds of people, and how to really make this country and these peoples united. And I think today we came a long way, and there are still a lot of differences between the East and the West, but so are between the North and the South. And so, I'm really happy for everything that happened in the past years, especially because my wife is coming from the South, and so she's coming from Bavaria, and so we have kind of a German unity in our home as well. And so, just for today, if you're not a German today, celebrate this day, because it was, a lot of years where this country was not united, and where we struggled with this, where families were not united, and where it was just difficult to see your loved ones. Another thing, I started a while ago to talk about the values of our church. We already talked about the S, a second chance grace place. We already talked about the A, all nation congregation. And today it's the first D, and the first D stands for doable discipleship. What does that mean? Pastor Wick, as you know, is not preaching very much for information. He is not telling you, well, this is the book in the Bible and this is the background and everything. He does not give you, he gives you this information as well, but he preaches more for transformation. He wants you to get something out of it for your everyday life, for all the things that happen in your life. You will hear that today as well. Another thing that we offer is, for every sermon that we offer, you can find Talk It Overs on our website in German, English, and Spanish for your small groups or just for yourselves. And there are questions to just reflect on the sermon and just to think about how can you implement those things in your life. there are other things as well, how we do doable discipleship. For example, in the small groups, we have a lot of small group studies that are very practical. A lot of books and other stuff that you can get at the connection table, even at the end of the service. And so we really want you to not just hear everything that Pastor Rick teaches or that our other teaching pastor teaches, but we really want you to be doers of the word, as James, as the book of James says. Another announcement is that next week, in 7 days, we are going to celebrate our 8th anniversary right here at Colonia Nova at 11 a.m. And we have a bunch of things planned for you. There are a lot of great things to drink, a lot of great things to eat. There are games for the children. And so I hope you will be here with us next week. You have to register online on celebrate.berlin/visit. And hope to see you next week right here as well. And right now we're about to hear from Pastor Rick, who's preaching today. This is with a sermon called Jesus' Secrets for Resilience. And so you will hear a lot about on how you can withstand the storms of life, how you can go through the stressful time that we are all in a very practical sermon. And so I will come back at the end of the service.
Hello, Saddleback. Have I told you lately that I love you? You know, I want to encourage you to take out your message outline right now, because this is going to be a very useful message that I know is going to help you a lot. So pull out your message notes wherever you are. Now, the reason I'm speaking to you from the farm is because I'm doing something this weekend that I hope every one of you will do before the end of the year. And it's this. I want you to plan a getaway with your small group. We have, 7,000 plus small groups at Saddleback Church. Plan a getaway with your small group on a day or a weekend. Just go away for a day. Or if you can, go away for a weekend. Plan something fun together. Plan a retreat. Believe me, after the last nearly 2 years of limited fellowship due to the COVID-19 pandemic, you need to plan a getaway with your small group and have some serious fellowship and some serious fun. That's why I'm modeling it for you this weekend. So I'm away with my small group that we've been together almost 20 years. Now, for most of you, I doubt that your schedule is as busy as mine is. And I don't want you to use busyness as an excuse for not getting away. So if you've got the desire to do this with your small group and you make a commitment to do it, you'll figure out a way to plan a fun getaway and a spiritual retreat with your small group. That's the doctor's orders this week. Now, this week I want us to continue with part 5 of my series called Strategies for Stressful Times. Specifically, we're going to look at how Jesus personally handled stress. And I want you to see what I call Jesus' 7 secrets of resilience. Now, maybe you've never thought about it, but the Bible says that we are to look to Jesus as our model for enduring tough times. The Bible says we are to look to Jesus as our model for enduring tough times. We are to follow his example of resilience, and we are to follow his example of stress management. And the Bible says it this way. If you've got your notes there, right at the top of your outline, Hebrews chapter 12 says this, verses 1-3 out of the New Living Translation. Since we are surrounded by such a crowd of witnesses to this life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily hinders our progress. And let us run with endurance. Underline that. Run with endurance the race that God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus. Do you see that? We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, on whom our faith depends from start to finish. Jesus was willing to die a shameful death on the cross because of the joy he knew would be his afterwards. And now he is seated in the place of highest honor beside God's throne in heaven. Think about all he endured. That's what we're talking about this weekend, resilience. Think about all he endured when sinful people did such terrible things to him, so that you, so that you don't become weary and give up. Now, what does that verse and passage tell us? Nobody experienced greater stress than Jesus Christ. He experienced enormous pressure. He was criticized constantly. He was misunderstood. There were constant demands on his life. He had little privacy, and there were people who were trying constantly to kill him. I doubt that's true of you, but that's stress. And yet, when we look at the life of Jesus Christ, we look at his ministry, we see that he walked and he lived with an amazing peacefulness. No matter how difficult the situation became, he modeled a calmness and a resilience in the face of outrageous demands. And this is why the book of Hebrews advises us to keep our eyes on Jesus. And that's what we're going to do today. We're going to watch his example of endurance. We're going to learn his secrets of resilience. And today, I'm going to unpack Jesus' 7 secrets of resilience. You're going to need this. So I want to encourage you to take notes. Now, we learn these 7 secrets of resilience from Jesus' own words. Let's get started. The first secret of resilience when you're under stress is this. Write this down. Remember how much God loves me. That's the first antidote to stress. It's the first secret of resilience. It is the principle of compassion. Jesus had no doubt in his mind that God the Father loved him. He talks about it over and over and over and over. Just one verse on your outline, John 10, verse 17. The Father loves me. The Father loves me. Now, knowing and remembering that God loves you unconditionally, and God loves you extravagantly, and God loves you continuously, and he will never stop loving you, that is the foundation. That's the first secret, the foundation of a resilient life. As Paul says in the book of Romans, if God's for us, who could be against us? Okay? Who could be against us? We are resilient because we know that God will never stop loving us. Now, I know what you're thinking. You think, well, of course God loves Jesus. He's his son. But did you know that Jesus said the same thing about you too? Yeah. In John 15, verse 9 and 10, it says this. Jesus says, just as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. And if you obey my commands, you'll remain in my love. Now, I've talked to you many, many times about how much God loves you because it is really the basis of your personal security. If you're not convinced that God always loves you, that he loves you unconditionally, completely, instantly, continuously, that he never stops loving you, that you can't make him stop loving you, if you don't really have this foundation of God's unconditional love in your life, you're going to be easy prey for the disapproval of other people. You're going to be a people pleaser. Now, how much does God love you? Well, look there on your outline. 1 John 3, verse 1 says this. How great is the love of the Father that he's lavished on us, that we should be called the children of God. And that is what we are. So the first key to resilience is to build the baseline that God will never stop loving me. Jesus knew it. You need to know it. Number two, the second key that we see in the life of Jesus, and you need this for your stress resistance, is this. Remember who I am. Don't just remember that God loves you unconditionally. Remember who I am. This is the principle of identification. Now, why is this important? Because if you're not sure who you really are, you're going to be whipped around and manipulated and molded by the pressures and the problems and the other people around you. When you have a confused identity, when you have an unclear identity, when you don't really know who you are, it makes you more prone to stress. Why? Because our culture will try to fit you in its mold. It's going to make you into what you want. It wants you to be. And until you settle this issue, first, God loves me unconditionally. Second, I know who I am. I'm a child of God. You're going to be prone to stress. Now, we know that Jesus never had any doubts about his identity. He knew exactly who he was. In fact, 18 times in Scripture, he publicly defines himself, 18 times. These are famous statements called the I am statements of Jesus, the I am statements of Jesus. I've listed just a few of them there on your outline. Mark chapter 14, John 8, John 14, John 6, many different places. Jesus says, I am, and then he fills it in. I am the light of the world. I am the Son of God. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. I am the bread of life. Over and over, he defines himself. He knew exactly who he was. Why is this helpful in knowing, in handling stress? Well, in John 8, 18, Jesus says, in other words, I testify to my own behalf. I don't need other people to tell me who I am. I know who I am. I don't depend on the opinions of others to validate myself. Do you do that? If you depend on the opinions of others to validate yourself, you are prone to stress. And you certainly aren't resilient to chronic stress. The fact is, if you don't know who you are, other people will decide it for you. They'll force you into a mold. They'll create stress. You'll end up pretending. You'll end up faking it. You'll end up wearing a mask. You'll end up trying to be a man or woman that you're not really who you are. You're who everybody else wants you to be. And that's called stress. Stress happens when you try to be something you're not. Doesn't matter if it's for the sake of your parents or the sake of your boss or the sake of your spouse or the sake of your boyfriend. Doesn't matter who you're doing it for. You're going to be pressured and you're going to be stressed and you're not going to be resilient. Now, you say, well, of course Jesus knew he was the light of the world. Of course he knew that. But did you know that Jesus said the same thing about you? He said, I'm the light of the world. But in Matthew 5, 13 to 16, Jesus says this, you are the light of the world. He says, you are the salt of the earth and you are the light of the world. Don't hide your light. Do you realize how special God says you are? There's nobody in the world exactly like you. When God made you, he broke the mold. Just like God doesn't make two snowflakes the same, God doesn't make clones of people. Even identical twins are different in thousands of different ways. There will never be, in the history of humankind, someone like you at all. You're unique. And you need to know that God loves you unconditionally, and you need to know who you are. Now, identity, this issue of identity, this is the second principle, the principle of identity. When you don't know your identity, it increases your stress. And it comes out two different ways, comparing and copying. Comparing, copy. Comparing when you say, well, I'm going to compare myself to everybody else. God says, don't do that. And copying others, we all begin as originals, but we end up as carbon copies of other people. God does not want copies of anybody. God does not want clones. That's why he only created one of you. God wants you to be you. And when you get to heaven, God isn't going to say, why weren't you more like Moses? The point is, you must become comfortable with being you. You must accept your strengths and you must accept your limitations and your weaknesses. You must accept the truth about you. When you do that, this second principle, the principle of I know who I am, you'll have a lot less stress. All right? Now, here's the third secret of resilience that we learn from looking to Jesus as our model. I know that God loves me. I know who I am. Here's the third thing. Know who I'm trying to please. Know who I'm trying to please. In other words, know who you're living for. Now, this is the principle of motivation. You need to know what is your deepest motivation. If you don't know that, if you haven't figured it out, you are prone to get stressed. What motivates you every day? You see, mixed motivations are a third great cause of stress. Jesus said, no man can serve two masters. This third cause of stress is trying to please everybody. The truth is, you can't. You get crowd A pleased, crowd B ticked off. About the time you get crowd B happy, crowd A is upset again. Did you know that even God can't please everybody? Somebody's praying for it to rain and somebody's praying for it to be sunny on the same day. Somebody's praying for some team to win and others praying for another team to win, or this guy to get elected and somebody else is praying for somebody else. You know, as a pastor, I have learned that for 42 years, I'm always disappointing somebody. Why? Because everybody has different expectations. okay? They have different expectations. The Bible says the fear of man is a trap. It will capture you. It will cause you to stumble. That's why Jesus says, in John 5:30, I'm not trying to do what I want, but only what my Father who sent me wants. I know who I'm trying to please. Now, if you're not trying to please God, in all likelihood, you're trying to please a bunch of people. It's a whole lot easier to say, I'm just going to focus on pleasing God and let the chips fall where they may. Because if you please God, it'll always be the right thing. If you don't please God and you're trying to please others, you just get stressed out with what this person wants, that person wants. This was the third reason Jesus was so stress resistant. He was only trying to please one person. Notice there in your outline, John 8:29. I always do those things that are pleasing to Him. And if you're pleasing God, it's always the right thing. It also simplifies your life. Because I don't have to worry about, am I pleasing everybody else? I'm just trying to please God. Jesus never let approval, or for that matter, rejection, control Him. He lived for an audience of one. As I mentioned earlier, Luke 16:13, no man can serve two masters. You can't please multiple audiences. He focused only on pleasing God. Now, this is what you need to do if you want to be resistant to stress, and if you want to be resilient to when you get knocked down. Galatians 1:10, Paul says, I'm not trying to be a people pleaser. This is Paul. I'm not trying to be a people pleaser. No, I'm only trying to please God. If I were still trying to please people, he says, I wouldn't be Christ's servant. I love that in the New Living Translation. One of the biggest myths that will make you miserable is this: I must be loved by everybody in order to be happy. That's just not true. You don't need other people's approval to be happy. But let me ask you, right now, whose approval are you depending on for your happiness? Who are you still trying to please? Some have been trying to please an unpleasable parent, and they've been dead for a while. You know, we love to blame other people for our stress. I have to do this. I must do this. I can't do that. The truth is, nobody's holding a gun to your head. You're not a victim. You are as free as you choose to be. Nobody can pressure you without your permission. That's why the third secret of resilience is, know who you're trying to please. Jesus said, I know who I'm trying to please. I'm only trying to please my Father. I'm not worried about anybody else. That's why we're looking at Him as our model. Now, here's the fourth thing that Jesus did. Here's the fourth secret of resilience and resistance to stress. I need to not only know God loves me, I need to not only know who I'm trying to please, I need to not only know that God has called me. That's the fourth thing. I know my calling. If you want to be resistant to stress, you need to get alone with God until you know your calling. I must know exactly and believe exactly what God has called me to do with my life. Now, this is the principle of vocation. And until you clarify this and it becomes crystal clear in your mind, you're going to be more prone to getting stressed out. But when you know what God's called you to do, you know what God has called you to do, you also know what God has called you not to do. In other words, when you're sure of your calling, you know what's your business, but you also know what's none of your business. And that simplifies life too. Jesus knew exactly what he was called to do. Here's the fourth thing. In John 8:14, he says, I know where I came from and I know where I'm going. To me, that sounds like a purpose-driven life. I know where I came from, and I know where I'm going. He lived a purpose-driven life. If you're to look up the word drive in the dictionary, it means to guide or to control or to direct. When you drive a car, you guide, control, direct it down the street. When you drive a nail with a hammer, you drive, guide, control, direct the nail into the wood. When you drive a golf ball, hopefully, you guide, control, direct it down the fairway. Every life is driven by something. Some people are driven by guilt. Some people are driven by fear. Some people are driven by the pressure of others. You're going to be guided through life by either pressure or purpose. Let me say that again. You will be guided through life by either pressures or purpose. And that's why this is Know Your Calling, Know Your Purpose. We have a whole series of classes on this at Saddleback Church. And when you know your purpose, then you determine what's important, the purpose or some people's idea for your life. What am I saying to you this weekend? That the direction of your life is your choice, okay? Nobody, as I said, nobody's holding a gun to your head. And by clarifying your calling and go, you know what? God shaped me in a certain way. That means whatever you're shaped to do is what you should be doing. But when you know your shape and you know what God's called you, then you can avoid the tyranny of the urgent. And until you clarify your calling, you're going to be controlled by others. How many times have you already learned that God loves you and everybody else has a plan for your life? James chapter 1, verse 8 says this. A person who has doubts is thinking about two different things at the same time. They can't make up their mind about anything. The Bible says you're wishy-washy when your purpose isn't clear, when your calling isn't clear. That's why Paul says in Ephesians 4:1, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Everybody has a calling. Not just missionaries or pastors or church leaders. Everybody has a calling. Some are called to be pharmacists. Some are called to be accountants. Some are called to be school teachers. Some are called to be cab drivers. Each day, you need to ask, am I moving toward my purpose? And that leads me to the fifth principle of resilience that we learn from looking to Jesus as our model. And here's what Jesus did. Number five, focus on what matters most. Focus on what matters most. Now, this is the principle of concentration. We've talked about, motivation, and we've talked about the compassion of God. This is the principle of concentration. And what I mean by this is when you know where you're headed and you focus, then you're not distracted by less important things. It's a matter of priorities. You know what matters most in life, and you focus on those things. As I said, everybody has a plan for your life. You know what I've discovered? That if Satan can't get you to do wrong, he'll just wear you out with too many good things. Yeah, yeah. Good things, there are a lot of good things you shouldn't do. Did you know that? Jesus was a master of concentration. He was a master of focusing his life. He focused his life like a laser. And he refused to be distracted. Let me show you some verses. Luke 9:51. Here's an example of this principle. As the time drew near for his return to heaven, Jesus moved steadily onward toward Jerusalem with an iron will. That's the Living Bible. What does that mean? He had a goal. He knew what his goal was. He knew he was going to die in Jerusalem. He's persistent. He's determined. He's focused. He focuses. He's clarified his priorities. Paul's the same way. Paul says, this one thing I do. Paul didn't say, these 40 things I dabble in. That's what we do. We dabble in 40 things. This one thing I do. If you want your life to count, if you want your life to have impact, focus is the name of the game. You know, you have incredible spiritual potential, but the barrier is often you haven't really settled what's most important. You know, I don't really have time to serve God. I would rethink that one. Okay, I would rethink that, knowing that one day you're going to stand before God and he's going to say, what did you do with what you were given? You know, some guys gave that same excuse to Jesus. Lord, let me first go do something else before I follow you. And that phrase, let me first, that's always the problem, me first. You can't say, Lord, let me first. Lord and me first are contradictory. Jesus said in Luke 9:62, anyone who lets himself be distracted from the work that I planned for him. God has planned a work for you to do. Anyone who lets him be distracted from the work I planned for him is not fit for the kingdom of God. The older I get, the more I realize selection is the name of the game. Lots of opportunities, lots of options, but the key to effectiveness is selection. 1 Corinthians 10:23 says this, we're free to do anything, but not all things are helpful. Not all things are profitable. Not all things are wholesome or constructive to your character and your spiritual life. I love that, the way it's brought out in the Amplified Translation. What is he saying? Some things aren't necessarily wrong. They're just not necessary. That's one of the keys to resilience. It's one of the keys to stress resistance. Now, here's the sixth secret of resilience that we learn from looking to Jesus as our model. This is a big one. Number six, spend time alone with God. Now, this secret of resilience and this secret of stress resistance may be the secret that you do the least, spending enough time alone with God. And yet, it is absolutely essential to building a resilient spirit and managing chronic stress. It is the principle of meditation. You know, prayer is a great stress reliever. It's a decompression chamber. It's cathartic. It's one of the ways to unload your burdens. The Bible says in Luke 22:39, it was Jesus' habit. Notice this on your outline. It was Jesus' habit to go to the Mount of Olives to pray, and his disciples followed him. Circle the word habit. How do you develop a habit? Well, a habit is something you develop through practice and through repetition. It's not a habit unless you do it over and over and over. It was his habit to go to the Mount of Olives. He would leave the city of Jerusalem, go across the valley to the Mount of Olives and pray there. Now, this next verse says, in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Do you have any time like that in your life? You need quiet times to renew, to reflect, to recharge. I want to challenge you on this principle of resilience. Study that Jesus was convinced of the fact that no matter how busy he was, he took time to get alone with God and pray. In Luke chapter 5, verse 15 and 16, we have a good example of it. It says, news about Jesus spread even more, and crowds came to hear him to be healed. But Jesus often slipped away to be alone so he could pray. Now, circle the word often. Often means frequently. If Jesus felt the need to frequently leave the crowd and get alone with God, how much do we need that? You know, I'd say as a pastor, the larger Saddleback gets, the more I find myself personally seeking solitude. It was the famous philosopher Pascal who said, most of our problems, man's problems, come from our inability to sit still. Psalm 46 says, be still and know that I'm God. Sit down and shut up. Would you agree that noise is a stress? Well, let me give you a suggestion. Start your morning with God instead of your phone, instead of TV, instead of radio. Set your mood with the good news. Colossians 2:7 says, plant your roots in Christ. Do that every morning. Plant your roots in Christ and let him be the foundation for your life. Now, there's one more secret of resilience that we learn from looking to Jesus as our model, and it's this. Number seven, it's what I'm doing this weekend. Get a small group for support. Get a small group for support. Do you know the first thing Jesus did when he started his ministry? He formed a small group. You see, you were never intended to handle stress by yourself. If I were to ask you to complete this sentence, if you want a job done right, you'd typically say, do it yourself. That's the motto of a perfectionist headed for burnout. If you want a job done right, do it yourself. You can't do every job by yourself. Now, if anybody had a right to say, if you want a job done right, do it yourself. If anybody had a right to say that, it was Jesus. Yet even Jesus knew the power of having a small group for support. And in Mark chapter 3, verse 14, it says he chose 12. That was his small group, designated them apostles that they might be with him. That's the point of a small group. He gathered a small group before starting his ministry. You know, so much of our stress, friends, is self-imposed. We get uptight when we think it all depends on us. It doesn't. God hasn't called you to be the general manager of the universe. Here at Saddleback Church, this church outgrew me decades ago. Decades ago. I could never do it all by myself. From the very start, my goal was to give the ministry away, even preaching. And that's why I have other guest preachers, because I think you need to hear God's word from more than just one voice. God never meant for the church to be a one-man superstar show. Even Jesus needed a small group for support. You remember that when he went to the Garden of Gethsemane before the cross in Matthew 26, verse 38, Jesus said to his disciples, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death." That's severe stress. And here's his antidote: stay here and keep watch with me. Even Jesus needed people to pray with him. Even Jesus needed the support of a small group when he was in a crisis. Why don't we accept help from other people? Well, there's a couple reasons: insecurity and pride. And it is insecurity, it's our own insecurity and our own pride that we don't accept help from others, so we stay stressed out. The fact is, there are people in this church family waiting to help you, waiting to support you, waiting to encourage you, waiting to assist you, if you'll just be humble enough to ask. Here's the secret: join a small group. If Jesus needed one, you need one. And the fact is, stress is increasing in our culture. So you have to take these 7 intentional steps to counteract it. It's not going to go away. Your life isn't going to get less stressful by accident. It only is going to get less stressful, more manageable, and you're going to have greater resilience if you choose to do these 7 things that Jesus modeled. Now, I want to close by reading again the passage that we started with in Hebrews 12, 1-3. Listen to it again in light of the 7 things that I gave you as a model from Jesus. Here's what Hebrews 12 says. "Since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily hinders our progress, and let us run with endurance." You've needed that the last 18 to 20 months. Run with endurance the race that God has set before us. We do this, he's going to give us the answer, we do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus from start to finish. Jesus was willing to die a shameful death on the cross because of the joy he knew he would be his afterwards. Now he's seated at the place of highest honor besides God's throne in heaven. Then it says this: think about all he endured. When you think you're going through a tough time, think about all what Jesus endured when sinful people did such terrible things to him, so that you don't become weary and give up. You know, I remember many years ago, this is going to date me, when the long-awaited 4th installment of Schwarzenegger's Terminator movie series came out. The 4th of the Terminator movies was called Terminator Salvation. And I remember reading an online review of this many years ago, and the review said this, quote, "In Terminator Salvation, most of humanity has been wiped out by a nuclear holocaust. A grown-up John Connors is fighting with the resistance. His adult life is certainly purpose-driven." Now, that caught my attention. This is a movie review. "His adult life is certainly purpose-driven. And this rebel with a cause has the weight of the world on his shoulders." You've heard that phrase, I'm sure, many times. We hear that phrase used when people are under intense stress. They had the weight of the world on their shoulders. But you know, friends, the truth is, only one person in all of history has ever carried the full weight of the world on his shoulders. It's Jesus. So in closing, I need to mention one more stress reliever that Jesus didn't need because he was the Son of God. What's the 7th or the 8th stress reliever? You need a Savior. You need far more than the model of Jesus. You need that. But you need Jesus himself in your life. You need his presence in your life. You need his power in your life. You need his pardon for your sins. You need his peace in your life. You need his salvation. We've looked at this verse before in this series, Matthew 11, 28, 29. Jesus said, come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke on you and let me teach you, because I'm humble and gentle, and you will find rest for your souls. You know what that verse is? It's salvation. This is salvation. Are you stressed out? Don't give up. Look up, because Jesus' offer still stands. Come to me. The single greatest source of stress in your life is this: trying to live your life apart from a daily connection to Christ. God is God, and you're not. And when I'm disconnected from Christ, or when you're disconnected from Christ, it causes all kinds of problems: fear, guilt, worry, loneliness. Come back to Christ today. Give him your stress. He's aware of the load you're carrying, and he says, I'll carry it with you. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, thank you for not only being a model for stress relief, a mentor for stress relief, but for being the answer to our stress. We need a Savior. If you've never opened your life to Christ, say, Jesus Christ, come into my life right now. I need a Savior. I need your power. Just say that. I need your power. I need your presence. I need your pardon for all the things I've done wrong. And I need your peace in my heart and in my mind. I open my life to your love. I need to not just practice your model, but I need to have a relationship with you. Please save me in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. First of all, let me say sorry to all of those who are sitting in this area. Because we had some problems with this beamer over there. We are still trying to find out the white setup, and we're pretty close. If you were here in the past weeks, this stage was already over there, then it was over there, and now it's over here. And we are very close. And sometimes when you do a service, there are surprises like the one today. We have no idea what happened, but we will find it out and we will work on that to not let it happen again. One thing that Pastor Rick talked about was small groups. And if you are with Setterback for a long time, you hear us a lot about talking about small groups. A few weeks ago, I gave a workshop at a Christian conference here in Berlin about the secrets of healthy small groups. And in these rooms, there were 20 different small group pastors from Berlin. And all of them said, well, it's so difficult to build healthy small groups. It seems like at some point, small groups just implode or just stop to exist. And especially during the pandemic, churches in Berlin and all around the world have found out how important small groups are. When you can no longer meet in a big crowd for worship service, those small groups were existential for a church. And so it's really, really important to me to point out that our small group ministry is not perfect. Because none of this, what's happening here in our church, is perfect. I don't believe that there is a perfect church. But we have a vision, and that vision for our small group is to be an integral part of who we are as a church. And I want Setterback to be known to be a church of healthy small groups. And so we are working in this direction. And I have a testimony for you today on a video. I would have loved to have someone here from Setterback Berlin to give that kind of testimony. But that testimony is so encouraging that I really want you to see that on what a small group can do during a pandemic. And so I hope you get encouraged by this testimony.
Well, when this pandemic started, I'll be honest, I wasn't really that scared, because I have felt the power and the love of the Lord Jesus Christ in my life for many, many years. In 1999, I was diagnosed with cancer. I was pregnant at that time. I survived that because the Lord is there. He, you know, He healed me. He provided for me. He has been proven His power, His blessing, His, you know, protection, and even provided for many, many years in my life. On February 1st, my husband started having a chill. And I go, "What's wrong with you?" And I go, "I'm having a chill." And then the following day, I was starting coughing. And then we called the doctor. And then the doctor said, "Come and get tested." The same day, we found out that we're positive. My small group, we've been together for about 7 or 8 years now. You know, we've been through a lot. We've been through a health issue, divorce, death in our family, you know. So they're there to support each other. We're there to support each other. We never felt alone. When my husband and I found out that we got infected with this COVID, I told my small group that my husband and I, we tested positive. I was so touched when each one of them, they come and they deliver food. They'll text us, "Mary Jane, what do you need? We're on our way to deliver food. Is there anything you need?" Every time we open the door, there's food in there, or flour, or fruits, or supplement. That's how having a small group is very, very important. When you go through trials like that, you're not alone. You're not alone. God is using them, you know? God is telling you, "Be still, know that I'm God, I will take care of you." I felt their love and their concern. They're my family. They're my spiritual family.
Testimony on the importance of small groups. And I know that we have some of those stories in our church as well. I know from my small group that during the pandemic, we went to care for a refugee family as well. We didn't make a big deal out of it. We just wanted to give them some blessings, and we went shopping for them. They now live in Turkey, but I never forget how all of our small group were like, "We need to do something. These are in our neighborhood." And I know that there are other small groups who cared for their neighbors, who cared for people that are part of their small group as well. And so if you're not in a small group yet, reach out to me, fill out a connection card, either an online connection card or the physical one that you are here, that you're looking for a small group. If you're saying, "Hey, I would love to lead a small group," get in touch with me as well. We have some great resources on how to lead a small group. It's not very difficult, and we give you a lot of support for that. And so I ask now Diasno and Brian to come up on stage again and close with a final song.
All right, it's been so great to worship with you again this Sunday, and we're going to sing our final song, and I invite you to stand with me or just sit if you would prefer that. See you.
Yes, you are with me. You are with me. You are with me through it all. Let's sing when the waters rise.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of our God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and evermore. Amen. Thank you so much for joining today. If you have any questions about small groups, about serving at Saddleback, if you know how to fix that beamer, then come to me after the service. I will be over there at the Connection Center and ready to talk. And now I ask Rosie, wanted to ask Rosie to come up because Rosie is leading our Saddleback Youth Ministry and we will. And so if you, come up on stage. if you are here today with your teens, tell us what they can do after the service.
We're just going to be hanging out a little bit, getting to know each other and chilling, and then we'll talk about what we have planned for the future, and hopefully that'll be really cool. So hope to see you upstairs.
Yeah. As she said upstairs, there's a rooftop terrace that you can hang out after the service. It's just one level upstairs. Hope you have time to go there and chat with the people in this room. Thank you so much for being here today. Have a great Sunday.